So the 25th of January, 1933, in Berlin, a cold day?
Very cold. Berlin, as you know, is one of the coldest cities. The wind blows directly from Siberia, they always say. And it did.
And what happened on that day?
Well, I think it was the last legal demonstration of the German Communist Party. Vast quantities of people turned up. Berlin was on the whole a very red city, or at least contained large red quarters. And we were marching, or rather shuffling along in the evening, singing songs, somehow or other, knowing that it wasn't going to do much good.
When you say knowing that it wasn't going to do much good, what was the political mood like in Berlin at that time?
The thing is, we knew that what was on the cards was Hitler coming to power in one way or another, the National Socialists. We knew that if this happened, the chances of communists would be very small. Officially, I think, the Communist Party said, yes, well, then there'll be the revolution. But we didn't really believe that we were going to have the revolution. We believed we were going to be the victims and we were going to stand up to persecution. And I think that was behind a lot of the feelings that as we were marching or shuffling, demonstrating, if you like, not only our strength, but if you like, our commitments.
You make it sound a bit like a funeral march.
In retrospect, it was a bit of a funeral march. We didn't see it, we just saw it as just a gesture of defiance.
And it was a demonstration, a march against the Nazis?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Can you remember the slogans?
I can't remember the slogan. I can remember the songs. The usual left-wing songs, you know. German songs, Russian songs.
Do any particularly stand out in your mind?
There were so many, somewhere or other in my archives, I still have a tiny little printed pamphlet of the texts of these songs, which I kept from that very occasion. I don't think the International was particularly prominent, although naturally we sang it. But various songs about Russian songs, Vashavyanka, then some songs about the German Revolution of 1918, you know, the Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg. Then even, I think, to some extent, some politically adjusted folk songs. Germans are great singers, as you know. And that was it.
And it was a large demonstration?
Enormous. I can't remember because, I mean, I was there in the middle. It was enormous. I can't even remember anybody making any speeches. I can remember this huge grey mass of people with red flags going through the cities in the evening, watched by police and others.
We've talked about the mass ecstasy of being on demonstrations of this sort. Did you feel it then?
Yes, but that's not a peculiarity of this particular demonstration. I mean, I can remember that very, very clearly, for instance, on the 14th of July, 1936 in Paris, which is just after the victory of the Popular Front, the feeling that everybody was, as it were, engaged. It's a collective lift-off, you might say. almost participation in almost any large-scale collective activity does have this effect, even if it's only watching a football final.
When you went on the demonstration on the 25th of January, you would have been 15. How does a 15-year-old get to be in the middle of such a historic event?
I was at that time being looked after, me and my sister, by an aunt who was trying to make a living in Berlin and kept a bit busy doing that and wasn't looking after us very well. If it had been my normal uncle and aunt who looked after us normally, who had by that time left, they wouldn't have allowed it. But my Aunt Mimi didn't really pay all that much attention to what we were doing because she was trying hard to make ends meet. And that's how I just went. I was then, of course, part of an organization of called officially socialist secondary students.
But that was a communist front organization.
Indeed it was, yes.
What made you a communist at the age of 14 or 15?
The sense that there was no present and no future unless there was an absolute fundamental change. You must realize that in Germany, in Central Europe, certainly Berlin, 31 to 33 was the bottom of the Depression. Moreover, it was clearly the end of a regime which couldn't last. There was no future. My schoolfellows, who were quite a lot, they weren't Nazis, they were German national mostly, imperial-minded, naturally believed the future would be a revival, a national revival, Germany revived. Well, I couldn't. I wasn't a German. I was a Jew, I was an Englishman. I was actually known as the Englishman in school rather than as a Jew. So that's the Weimar Republic. But this kind of nationalism didn't work. Social democracy and liberalism clearly didn't work because you could see these parties collapsing in front of you during that time in Berlin, in Germany. And so a revolution seemed a logical thing to be. I wasn't the only one. I mean, it was a time when people did turn to the left very, very sharply. I was perhaps a little young to do so, but you could not be political.
And the political loyalty you developed in those months in Berlin stayed with you?
Well, as far as I'm personally concerned, this has clearly been a fundamental experience in my life, you know, which sort of determined what I became afterwards. Not just simply because I was politicized, but being in Berlin at the time, you were living in a sort of, in a scene of volcanic eruption of cultural intelligence. Things were happening, and things were happening to somebody who was at my age, who was just about beginning to discover themselves as no longer a child. And the idea was, it was enormously exciting. When I came over to England afterwards, I found I was bored stiff compared with this. It didn't get anywhere near as interesting until years later when I went to Cambridge, you know. And so this atmosphere you've got to remember. But basically it was a feeling that you were living in a time which could not last, when the traditional ways of dealing with the future had failed, were visibly failing. You could see them being failing. I mean, the Democratic Party, for instance, which had founded the Weimar Republic. In my family, they were discussing, you know, there were several elections in 31, 32, and so on. The Democratic Party, by that time, it was down to 1.2% and called the Party of the German State. You could see that's the one that probably my people would have voted for had they been in Germany. But there was no future to it. No, none.
Do you remember any event which symbolised for you the menace of the rise of National Socialism?
It's a difficult one to reconstruct because we were living in an atmosphere of of violence, of violent action. But unlike more recent period, when it's a general atmosphere of violence, it was controlled violence, in a sense that the Nazis, the official Nazi party, would officially defend some characters who had been seen murdering some Poles and stuff like that. There were street fights between militant Nazis, stormtroopers, and organized armed communists and others. We saw one or two of them, but we were aware of them. It wasn't that you could see them every time you went on the street, but we were aware that this was happening. And we were certainly aware of the brutality of the Nazis, no question about it.
Could you say that last sentence again?
We were certainly aware of the brutality of the stormtroopers. They went around bragging about it.
Did you ever see Hitler?
No. I don't know that he came to Berlin, heard him on the radio, heard Goebbels.
When you heard them on the radio, what sort of event was this? Was this the family gathering around, or was this just casual listening to the radio and he happened to be on?
I think the family would certainly try and make a point of listening to him, because after all, you don't hear Satan talking every day. And we knew, and this was it, you see, we knew that what was going to happen was not merely changing my life, but changing European history. Possibly, you may say, changing world history. And to try and recover a sense of living at a time when you know you're living at a historic turning point. There aren't very many. I mean, for instance, I can remember the first day of the Second World War, when one also had this sense. To know, it's very hard if you go through a long life to know whether at any particular moment you say to yourself, I am now living at a point which people will remember forever. And those months in Berlin were such a moment.
Can you say that thought again for me, please? There was just a bit of background noise. Talking about, you know, in the course of a long life.
In the course of a long life, one asks oneself, how often does one live a moment when you say, this is going to be remembered because of the world-changing effect it has? It will never be forgotten. the fall of the Weimar Republic and the rise of Hitler was one of them. And maybe one, two others. But it is an extraordinary experience to be at something where you actually live it rather than you read about it in some kind of newspaper or see it in the television and say, this is world-changing. It's something that happens that you are involved in. And I suppose it means that one's memory is not very reliable because it has to carry such a lot of emotional weight as well as such a lot of historical weight. So I never like to say this is what it was like unless I can check it against things which are not simply what I can remember, because I've been reconstructing my memories about it. That's what people do about such great moments, don't they? But it was such a moment.
And 5 days after that nighttime march through Berlin?
Well, yes, it wasn't a finish, you see. I mean, I was an organised and this socialist schoolboy thing. And so we went around, particularly when they organised elections. And then, of course, they were expecting to be made illegal. And as I was English, I was involved, you know, they try and put the duplicator into my bedroom and stuff like that. They brought it in from somewhere outside.
This was after Hitler had become Chancellor.
Yes, oh yes. Yes, I mean, we were engaged in actual anti-Hitler activity for those 2 or 3 months until my own family then left and went to England. So that you can't say it was the end. But we knew by that time that, I mean, we had lost. We weren't expecting it. A lot of people, I think, said he can't last. It's too crazy. Much the way in which people say about some loonies in American politics. How can they possibly? I think we and my friends believed he could last and would last. The idea that he wouldn't last didn't strike us. It wasn't going to be attempted. Although I believe the Communist Party had illusions that they could possibly hold him up. But
looking back on your youth in Berlin 80 years later, do you have a sense of pride that you were there and you did what you could to stop Hitler?
Well, I don't know, you see. To some extent, there was this element of playing cowboys and Indians. And if you're 15, you do have a sense of that too. At the same time, we did know that there was genuine risk. A real risk, and consequently, to that extent, we knew that we were actually doing something dangerous. We were dangerous not only to ourselves but to our families. Well, of course, it's nice to think that one actually did do something, however little. After that, I suppose, particularly after the Reichstag fire trial, one had to ask oneself, how scared are we while we're doing this? insofar as we were genuinely scared, I think probably there's something to be proud of.
Thank you very much.
Okay.